We see it every day, but few of us ever ask where it begins. What is light really? What is a photon? And how does one come into being? If this is your first time exploring the science of light, don't worry, I've got you. And if you already know the basics, stay with me because this video goes deeper than most textbooks or other videos do. And I promise you, this information will blow your mind. Because photons don't just appear. They're made from motion, from heat, from electric fields, from the tiniest particles inside atoms, and even the very structure of space itself. Let's begin by talking about some of the most familiar forms of light. Light that begins inside atoms. Everyday light bulbs, stars, and even the glow of neon signs all rely on a simple process. Electrons absorbing energy, then releasing it as light. To understand how that really works, we need to start by understanding what a photon really is. A photon is the smallest possible unit of light, but more precisely, it's a quantized packet of the electromagnetic field. It has no mass, it has no charge, but it carries energy, momentum, and spin. You can think of it as a ripple in the electromagnetic field. A perfectly discrete burst of electric and magnetic waves traveling through space together. It's not made of smaller parts. You can't have half a photon, and that's why we say it is quantized. Quantized means something comes in fixed steps, like stairs. You can stand on one or the next, but never in between. Photons work the same way. You don't get a continuous flow of light energy. You get bursts. Each photon has a specific amount of energy based on its frequency. Higher frequency equals higher energy. Lower frequency equals lower energy. And frequency is tied to wavelength, the distance a wave travels before it repeats. Short wavelength, high energy. Long wavelength, low energy. And this is what gives light its color, its heat, and its power. And here's something subtle but important. Photons always travel at the speed of light, but only in a vacuum. When they move through a material like air, glass, or water, they slow down. Not because they lose energy, but because they're constantly being absorbed and re-emitted by the atoms inside. This process is what we call refractive index. It tells you how much slower light moves in a given substance. So let's bring this all together. A photon is a quantized electromagnetic packet of energy. It travels at light speed in a vacuum and just slightly less than everything else. It carries no mass, but it does carry energy. And it can be born in several ways. One of the most common ways, and one you might be familiar with already, is inside atoms. Every atom contains electrons orbiting the nucleus and fixed energy levels. Picture them like steps on a ladder or the stairs we mentioned earlier. These levels are not continuous. An electron cannot hover between them. It must commit to a level. So when an atom absorbs energy, maybe from heat or collision or another photon, an electron can jump to a higher level. This is called excitation, but that excited state doesn't last long. Eventually, the electron falls back down to its original level. And when it does, it releases the excess energy as a photon. Then that photon leaves the atom carrying the exact amount of energy the electron lost. Its frequency, its color, and even its direction are all determined by that transition. This is exactly how most of the light you come in contact with is created. But some are born from something more primal, motion itself. From atoms jostling in heat, to charged particles whipping through magnetic fields, to sudden decelerations that shake energy loose. In this next section, we'll explore how kinetic energy becomes light through thermal radiation, synchrotron emission, and breaking radiation. Whenever a charged particle moves or changes how it moves, it disturbs the electromagnetic field. And those disturbances, they can ripple outward as light. That is the thread that ties this section together. Whether it's the slow shimmer of thermal radiation, The curved sprint of synchrotron motion, or the sudden jolt of breaking radiation, light emerges from motion itself. Let's explore these. Every object in the universe with temperature, from a star to a stove burner to your own body, is constantly emitting light. This is called thermal radiation, and it comes from one simple fact: heat is motion. As atoms vibrate and charged particles, especially electrons, jostle around, they disturb the electromagnetic field. Those disturbances ripple out as photons. The hotter the object, the more intense that motion, and the more photons it emits. This is why metal glows red when it's hot, why stars shine across the spectrum, and even why a cold cup of coffee emits a faint infrared glow. The pattern of this emission follows something called Planck's law. It predicts how much light is emitted at each wavelength, depending on the object's temperature. Cooler objects glow red, hotter ones glow white or blue, and extremely hot ones emit ultraviolet or even X-rays. We call this glow black body radiation, the ideal case of an object that perfectly absorbs and emits light. And while no material is perfect, many come surprisingly close. Molten rock, incandescent filaments, even the early universe. So even without quantum jumps, light can emerge from heat itself, from the chaotic ballet of atoms in motion. Now imagine a single charged particle like an electron moving near the speed of light through a magnetic field. That field bends the particle's path, and each time it curves, the particle loses energy. That energy is released as light. This is synchrotron radiation, first seen in particle accelerators, but now known to fill the universe. It is how we detect radio waves from supernova remnants, X-rays from the edges of black holes, and the high-energy glow of pulsars spinning in space. The light it creates is narrow, bright, and polarized, perfect for scientific study. And we now harness it ourselves in specialized labs called synchrotron light sources. Here, scientists accelerate electrons and bend them with magnets. They do this to generate beams of light so powerful they can study proteins, materials, and fossils, atom by atom. It's motion made visible, a charged particle's journey written in photons. But not all motion is smooth. Sometimes it ends abruptly. When a fast-moving electron gets near a nucleus, its path bends hard, like a car taking a sharp turn. And just like that car loses speed, the electron loses energy. That lost energy is released as light. This is Bremsstrahlung, or breaking radiation. It shows up in X-ray machines, in nuclear reactions, and in high-energy regions of stars. Anywhere particles are flying fast and getting yanked off course, Bremsstrahlung is likely there. It's a reminder that photons can emerge not just from elegant transitions, but from raw disruption, from sudden stops. So far, we have seen light created by structure, electron shifting levels, and by motion, through heat, curves, and collisions. But what if light could be born without matter at all? No electrons, no atoms, no particles. What if light could emerge from the vacuum itself? That is where we're headed next, into the strange world of quantum fields, where energy flickers out of emptiness, and the boundaries of something and nothing begin to blur. In the quantum world, reality gets stranger. Light can emerge from fluctuations in empty space, from the disappearance of particles, or even from violating light speed. Sort of. In this section, we'll look at three photon birth processes that challenge our classical intuition. I know it sounds impossible, but in quantum physics, the vacuum is not empty. It's a restless sea of potential, a churning background of uncertainty and fluctuation. Physicists call it the quantum vacuum, and it's not made of particles, but of probabilities. According to quantum field theory, every field, like the electromagnetic field, is always fluctuating, even in its lowest energy state. That means even in empty space, virtual particles can briefly emerge, borrow energy from the vacuum, and vanish again. One of the clearest examples is the dynamical Casimir effect. Imagine two mirrors placed very close together in a vacuum. If one of them moves fast enough, close to the speed of light, those vacuum fluctuations can get amplified. And when they do, something strange happens. Photons appear, real, measurable light, emerging from what we once thought was nothing. The movement of the mirror provides the input, but the transformation, the conversion of motion into photons, relies on the vacuum's restless nature. Even more exotic, this may be part of what happens at the edge of a black hole. Hawking radiation is believed to form when virtual particle pairs appear near the event horizon and one escapes as real light. It's a vivid reminder that nothing in quantum physics is never truly nothing. Now, some of the purest forms of light don't come from heat, pressure, or motion. They come from disappearance. When a particle meets its exact opposite, a particle-antiparticle pair, they can annihilate one another. And when they do, they don't leave behind wreckage. They become light. The most famous case is the electron and its antiparticle, the positron. Same mass, same spin, opposite charge. When they collide, they don't just bounce or break apart. They vanish and release their combined energy in the form of two gamma ray photons. This process follows Einstein's famous equation, E equals mc squared. Mass becomes energy, matter becomes light. It's one of the few ways we know of where energy conversion is nearly perfect. No fragments, no waste. Just two photons, each flying off in opposite directions to conserve momentum. This is not just theory, it's happening constantly, actually. In particle accelerators, when electrons hit positrons head-on, in the early universe, when temperatures were high enough for those pairs to form and destroy rapidly, and in PET scans, which detect the gamma photons from positron annihilation in the body. Annihilation is a kind of cosmic balance sheet, where matter and antimatter cancel out, and the leftover is light. It reminds us of something profound, that energy can take many forms, and sometimes the end of something solid is just the beginning of something radiant. I know we're told nothing can move faster than light, and that's true, but only in a vacuum. In materials like water and glass, light actually slows down. Its speed drops because it keeps interacting with atoms along the way. But some particles don't slow down. Imagine a high-energy particle, like an electron, blasting through water after being released by a nuclear reaction or cosmic ray. It's still moving near the speed of light in a vacuum, but it's faster than light can travel through that medium, and it creates a kind of shockwave. Just like a jet breaking the sound barrier creates a sonic boom, a particle breaking the light barrier in a medium creates an optical boom. This is Cerenkov radiation, and it glows a distinctive eerie blue. You've probably seen it in photos of nuclear reactors. Those glowing pools aren't just for cooling. They're glowing because a particle slicing through water, leaving a cone of light behind. Here's what's really happening. As the particle outruns the local speed of light, it temporarily polarizes the atoms along its path, disturbing their electrons. When those atoms relax, they emit light in a cone, like a ripple expanding outward. That cone of light is the Cerenkov radiation. It's not just pretty, it's useful. Physicists use it to detect high-energy particles. Medical researchers use it in imaging. And in particle physics, it's one of the best ways to trace what's happening inside a detector. Cerenkov radiation is nature's way of saying, something just moved too fast to be quiet. It's light born from tension, from the mismatch between what a particle is doing and what its environment can keep up with. So far, we have seen light born from structure, from motion, and now from the quantum fabric of reality. But nature is not finished. Some forms of light are so unusual, so unexpected, they don't fit neatly into any category at all. From sound waves collapsing bubbles, to chemicals glowing in the dark, to living creatures creating their own shine, next we will explore some of the strangest and most beautiful ways light can be created. Some materials absorb high energy light, like ultraviolet, and re-emit it almost instantly at a lower energy. This is fluorescence. It's why some minerals glow under a black light, and how certain dyes or proteins are tracked in biology labs. But as soon as the energy source is gone, the light stops. It's instant, on and off. Then there is the slower cousin of fluorescence. Here, the energy gets temporarily trapped in a forbidden state and takes longer to escape. That is why glow-in-the-dark stickers still shine after the lights are off. The light takes time to leak out. In both cases, electrons absorb energy and re-emit it. But the time scale is what makes phosphorescence linger. Ever bite into a wintergreen lifesaver in the dark and see a spark? That's triboluminescence, light created by mechanical stress. When certain crystals or bonds are fractured, the shift in charge or bond breakage can release photons. It is still not fully understood, but here, light is born from breaking. Now let's talk about one of my favorites, light from sound. Yes, you heard that right. If you think we should do a full video on this, let me know in the comments below. This occurs when a high-frequency sound wave collapses a tiny bubble in a liquid. A burst of light can flash from inside. It lasts just a trillionth of a second, but it is real and intensely bright. Some call it a mini star in a jar, and while the mechanism is still debated, it hints at extreme energy focusing on small scales. Even nature figured out photon creation long before we did. Bioluminescence is when living organisms produce light through chemical reactions, usually involving luciferin and luciferase. Fireflies, deep sea fish, glowing fungi, they all use bioluminescence to communicate, hunt, or survive. It is light with purpose, and it reminds us that photon creation is not just physical, sometimes it's biological. So now we've seen it all, light from quantum jumps, from motion, from collisions, from the vacuum itself, and from the chemistry of life. Some forms are common, others are rare. Some are fully understood, others still carry mystery. But every one of them tell us the same thing. Light is never just light. It's energy made visible. A trace of motion, memory, and transformation. Flickering into being again and again. So what is light, really? It's more than just brightness, more than something we can see. A photon can be born from an electron falling into place, from the heat of jostling atoms, from a particle bent off course, or from a ripple in the vacuum itself. It can emerge from silence, from tension, from disappearance, even from life. We have seen photons born in stars, in machines, in sound waves, and in bodies. Some last for billions of years, some vanish in a blink. But they all carry energy, and they all leave a trace. A photon is a message from matter, from motion, from the universe itself, translated into something we can sense. And if you've made it this far, you are part of a rare kind of curiosity, the kind that does not stop at surface explanations. If this resonated with you, consider subscribing, because here we don't just learn science, we illuminate it. Once you see how light is made, you begin to realize it is more illuminating than ever imagined. In the warmth on your skin and the colors of the sky, in the quiet blue glow beneath a reactor, and the fire in a beetle's belly. Photons are not just the currency of sight. They are the signature of change. And whether they are born from atoms, acceleration, or nothing at all, they remind us that even the smallest ripple can light up the world.